Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us at day two of From Classroom to Boardroom, a virtual event series addressing issues of equity in the workplace and inclusive economic recovery in Charlottesville, Virginia, and in communities across the country. Thank you to the United Way of Greater Charlottesville, the University of Virginia, and Virginia Tourism Corporation for their support in bringing this program to life, as well as countless other partners and collaborations in our hometown and beyond. Today's panel will highlight successes and challenges from the early days of expanding Network2Work, an innovative workforce development program pioneered by Piedmont Virginia Community College that connects job seekers to high quality careers and wraparound supports. Leaders from the Shenandoah Valley, Hampton Roads, and Greater Richmond regions are gathered here today to provide insight on the program and the different ways it is taking shape in their local communities. With that, let's bring on the panelists, and I'll send it over to Ridge Schuyler, Dean of Community Self-Sufficiency Programs at Piedmont Virginia Community College, to get started.
Thank you so much, Ben. I appreciate that. And good morning, everyone. I am Ridge Schuyler, and I would like to take a moment to introduce our panelists, and I am going to do it geographically. Network2Work is expanding from the coast to the mountains. And so I thought introductions would start from the coast to the mountains. And so I'd like to introduce Lisa Z. She's with the City of Newport News, where she's a project manager in the city manager's office. Next, moving from east to west, is Elizabeth Creamer. She's the vice president for workforce development and credential attainment at the Community College Workforce Alliance in Richmond. Welcome, Elizabeth. And then last but not least, my colleague from over the mountain, Sharon Johnson, who is the CEO of the Shenandoah Valley Workforce Development Board, Inc. Sharon, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Good morning.
And while I'm sharing thanks, I thought I would kick this off by thanking the Tom Tom Festival. Tom Tom, you know, is their mission is connecting communities. And I would just like to make a note about a connection that they made early on. It just so happens that the very first time I publicly discussed the Network2Work framework was April 13th of 2013 at the Tom Tom Festival. I spoke at the Haven, and it was the first time that I described this effort of connecting employers who offer great wages and careers for job seekers, connecting them to the job seekers who've been left behind in our economy, who could take advantage of those great jobs and careers, and the resource providers in our communities who can help that job seeker get from here to there. That 2013 discussion really was born out of experience I had in 2012 working on the Obama campaign in Virginia, where we used neighborhood team leaders to talk about a presidential candidate. And after that experience, I thought if we could use a neighborhood-based model to connect people to a candidate, couldn't we use the same model to connect job seekers with the incredible opportunities that surround them? So the last connection I'll mention and thank Tom Tom was in April of 2019. I spoke again at the Tom Tom Festival with Dr. Frank Friedman from Piedmont Virginia Community College. It just so happened that representatives from Governor Northam's office were in the audience. They then invited me to expand Network2Work into the other locations that you're going to hear about today. And that's how I got connected with the great panelists you're going to hear from today. So TomTom is all about connections, and I do appreciate all the connections that they've helped us make at Network2Work. So I'm going to start this off by asking panelists who have spent a lot of their careers focusing on workforce development, what brought you to the world of workforce development? And I'm going to start in the middle of the state with Elizabeth Creamer. Elizabeth, what brought you into the world of workforce development?
Well, thank you for asking that question. Network2Work probably has so much appeal and power for me, largely because of my own story. And that's because at the age of 28, I found myself with three children, no job skills, no post-secondary education, no plan for the future, and on my own. And I had been married and married since 18, two children by 20, and I had no idea where to start. And I did manage to get through a baccalaureate program, but I don't remember having any career direction whatsoever during my university education. And I just remember the fear and thinking there's got to be a better way to help people, to find living wages and an opportunity at a future.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for sharing that story. Let's go over to Sharon Johnson. Sharon, what brought you into the world of workforce development?
Well, I actually grew up on a farm, so I don't ever remember a time when I was not working. And I always knew that the work that I did had meaning and it made a difference, and it directly impacted the bottom line of our business. And I knew that from the very beginning. Then as I got into the workforce development arena and things like training, corporate training leading up to that, I just believe that if every individual had the opportunity to use their talent and their skills and somebody believing in them that they could, and that they were doing meaningful work, making a difference with purpose, that it would solve, and they were making, of course, a living wage either for themselves and or their family, that it would solve many, many of the problems that we have today.
Thank you, Sharon. So where was the farm you grew up on?
In Augusta County, in Hermitage.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So I actually grew up on a farm in Orange, Virginia. So, you know, sharing that, I broke a lot of farm equipment, which is why they moved me off the farm and into something else. Lisa Z, tell us how you got into the world of workforce development.
Okay, let's see. My husband and I have always had some kind of small business, and we ended up deciding to kind of exit that world and go back to school and get degrees. And I became a marketing education instructor, what we call career and technical ed these days, CTE. And I saw a huge difference in helping individuals kind of start, get some work experience when they're young. Then I moved into Voc Rehab as a business development manager and an external training option coordinator with Woodrow Wilson Rehab Center and Virginia Department of Aging and Rehabilitative Services. And I definitely enjoyed that. Then I moved into the world of WIA, which is now WIOA, Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, under Department of Labor at the local Hampton One Stop, which is now an America's Job Center. And I moved up to the workforce board level, and I've always had a passion to help people, especially those that are they're kind of quiet, don't know how to ask, don't know how to find the resources. And I really try to connect people with the right resources. Turned out a lot of friends of mine have gone through career changes and been let go, and they kind of came to me and I said, it's really hard to find it. And the joke was that the workforce board and the one stop were the best hidden secret. And it's really hard to get that word out because there's not really marketing money, right? So when you came and presented, I'm now at the City of Newport News doing a lot of workforce projects and grants, loving that. And we have the Choice Neighborhood Initiative. But when you came, we were like light bulb, you know, connecting everybody, because they can't always get to the one stop, or it's a 2-hour bus ride, or they have no clue that it's out there. But everybody has a cell phone. Everybody lives on a cell phone.
The light bulb was actually the shine off my head.
I wanted to thank you and the TomTom Foundation and Ben for having us, because this is a dynamite tool, definitely.
Well, thank you. And what I've heard from each of you in your own way is it's about unleashing human potential, whether it's your own, in Elizabeth's case, or the community that surrounds you, as in the case of Sharon and Lisa. It's about unlocking human potential. And I think that is the key to this kind of work. And just to bootstrap off of what Elizabeth said, I think the reason I got into it is because my mom was a single mom in the 1960s with four young boys, when being divorced was not a thing. And employers would look her in their eye and legally say, I'm not going to hire you because you're a single parent and you'd be home with your sick kids all the time. And so fortunately, we're past those days, but it's still very hard for single parents to find their way into the workforce and up a career ladder. So I really appreciate the work that you all did and have done, and what's brought you into it. So talking about unlocking human potential, it is very hard to reach your potential if you are struggling financially. And I think we all just know that intuitively. The research bears that up. In our region of Charlottesville, sadly, one out of every five families does not earn enough to be self-sufficient. And that struggle is not equally shared. 35% of Black families in Charlottesville make less than $35,000 a year compared to 14% of white families. So this income disparity is real and it is challenging. So I wanted to ask you all next, based on your experience, what is the main challenge you have seen that job seekers face in trying to get into jobs and careers that can pay a family sustaining wage and allow people to support their families, which is really what people strive to achieve? Sharon, I'm going to start with you with that question. What challenges do job seekers face in trying to get up the career ladder?
Well, thanks, Ridge. I think the challenges are many, ranging from everything from they don't know where to go for help. There can seem to be so many resources out there, and where can they start and where can they go? Or they're not aware of anything being out there and don't know where to go. So then you have also the challenge of individuals who want to find a job who need supports, or they have barriers to employment, and they don't know about transportation and how they're going to get a dependable way to get back and forth to work. Childcare is an issue. It could be an issue about, well, how in the world can I pay for training and take care of my family and have money coming in? I don't have money coming in. How am I going to make all of this work for me? So supports with anything from tuition and books and uniforms and work boots and tools and so forth, all of these things. And then some of them, of course, have all of these challenges and more on top of that. So you're dealing with individuals who have barriers and need to know what supports are out there that you've got to get straight first before even starting the job search. Then when you get to the job search, there's the problem of how do I look for a job? And we can be dealing with individuals who truly don't know the first thing about looking for a job, or who last time they looked for a job was 35 years ago and are not at all familiar with using an online application and things like that. So I think that we find in some of our centers that the underserved population that we're really trying to reach, they don't necessarily feel comfortable coming into a center for whatever reason. So we are finding that the best thing that we can do as part of this network to work model is to have access points where we go out to the people, we go out to where they are, especially being in a rural area and transportation being such a big issue. So we want to go out with to where they are, and with this model, this service delivery model, these are big problems, and you can't rely on one organization like the Workforce Development Board or Center to handle that. So this service delivery model, it looks at the community and all the nonprofits and all the organizations in the community who help to work together to provide this support through advocates and connectors and navigators, volunteers, and then through all of the resources that are out there in the community. So the barriers and the challenges with job seekers are many.
So Lisa, building off of that, what challenges either similar to what Sharon just mentioned or others that you have seen, but in your many years of doing this work and the various different roles that you described that brought you into workforce development, talk to us about some of the real challenges that folks who have been left behind in our economy face as they try to sustain their families.
So technology, but they're learning through their phones. So here again, network to work is valuable because it's a new habit that everybody's embraced. Transportation, probably reading and math levels, and then not knowing where all these resources are. You know, we have the 211 guides across the state. We have the one stops, we have the community services boards, we have adult ed, we have different grant programs. So unless you're in that world and keeping in touch, and a lot of times we still learn what our partners are doing, there's no way somebody trying to come into this is gonna understand. So I think the benefit, in addition to your mobile app, is the positions that you have with this model. And the one would be the navigator. So somebody could have a person, a community connector, a faith-based leader, somebody that's recognized and branded in the community, help them get onto the app and answer some few non-private questions. And then they would be connected with a navigator to help them. But in general, you know, I've worked with military spouses. They're always discriminated against because they're moving. I've worked with returning citizens. They're always, not always, but discriminated against. It's difficult. Their market gets much smaller on their opportunities. And you have to have the credentials. In today's world, you have to have the certs, the credentials, the ability to move. And they have a real hard time finding the point one to point two to point three to get there, the pathway.
Elizabeth, you want to hop in? Challenges that you've seen work job seekers face, including your own challenges?
Yes. Well, 50% of jobs require some sort of credential. That's data from the National Skills Coalition. We know that 69% of employers that are seeking some kind of technically skilled worker are having trouble finding workers. So there's this need for credentials. There's certainly a population that remains underrepresented in higher education. We need alternative pathways to success, and they have to involve training for jobs that offer family and self-sustaining wages. The jobs are there. In the Greater Richmond MSA, even in the pandemic, even with at points during this pandemic, our unemployment rates having tripled, and you know, then they've gone back and forth, risen and fallen since then. But even at the height of the pandemic, we still had employers in manufacturing and information technology, in healthcare, in trades and trades and trades. We hear about trades all the time, clamoring for workers. And these are positions that don't require a baccalaureate, that are now accessible to those who don't have the time or the financial means or the inclination to pursue traditional college. They may have dependent children. There, for the first time in Virginia in the last few years, we've done some really concentrated work to create alternate routes to success for working adults, to help them get out of the cycle of part-time jobs that aren't really leading anywhere in terms of self-sustainability. But even with that, getting people through a credential, getting them good career coaching, thoroughly grounded as to what their aptitudes and interests are, on a pathway to a credential that matters with a known employer who's ready to accept them, that can't be the job just of community colleges. It's not enough just to deliver the workforce training. What my 19 years of workforce development have taught me first and foremost, and I've spent all of it working with community colleges and totally dedicated to the premise that education, training, credentialing does lead to higher wages. There's plenty of data to show that, does lead to better lives. But even with all that, I have learned we have to have partners. We are not inherently the best at finding transportation solutions, childcare solutions. We are not the best at referrals to behavioral specialists or to financial literacy specialists. So in the Greater Richmond MSA, our Network2Work pilot is thoroughly invested in the fact that it can't be just a community college creation. It can't be just a workforce board creation. It is a coalition. It is born of a coalition that is comprised of the Capital Region Workforce Board, the community colleges in the region, and Community College Workforce Alliance, which is our workforce development division. But it's also Chamber RVA for the business connection. It's Office of Community Wealth Building from the City of Richmond for their neighborhood ambassadors that are going to serve as navigators and really know the neighborhoods where we need to be thoroughly invested and active. And it's got United Way of Greater Richmond and Petersburg with their wide knowledge, wide and deep knowledge of workforce development needs. They are leading the service providers network with 39 different service providers. It's taking each and every one of us to make the impact we want to make on eradicating poverty, and particularly in our neighborhoods, our communities of color.
So I wanted to tug on a couple of things that you all said, and I think building off of what Elizabeth said, you know, there are credentials there out in the world that are valued by employers that can make the difference between somebody who is worth $7.25 an hour and someone who might be worth $15 an hour or $22.50 an hour. But we all know that you could be the best credentialed person in the world, but if you can't get to work, then that credential doesn't serve you very well. And I think it's to Liz's point about these wraparound services. And I wanted to tug on that for a minute. Both Lisa Z and Sharon mentioned transportation. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to have you all talk about that from your perspectives, because Lisa, you know, I think there's a default belief that if you live in an urban area that has some kind of public transit system, that transportation is taken care of and we can check that box. And Sharon, in a rural places like you have in the Shenandoah Valley, obviously public transportation isn't going to be the option. So what do folks do out in the rural country to address that transportation challenge? And how does technology help us do that? And what are the challenges with technology? Because that was another thing that you all mentioned. And maybe technology can help with the transportation challenge. So I'm going to start with you, Sharon, on the what are the transportation options in rural America, and how does technology maybe help overcome the transportation challenge, or does it?
Well, first of all, regarding transportation, this is always an issue in our region. And we do have some public transportation, not much at all, as you mentioned, as you can imagine. We do provide vouchers for individuals who either take public transportation or who take a cab or an Uber. We have looked at some best practices from other regions in the nation that have gone under contract with Uber to provide transportation. We are actively right now looking into how the best way, the most economical way to try to procure or to in partnership work with getting a van to use. We also do have nonprofit providers who do have bus services that we work with and that are part of our provider network. So we have that. And we have had examples in our region in the past and have been working with whatever entity is interested in looking into, whether it's childcare, in this situation with transportation, and to see if we can get a group of businesses that are closely located geographically and to have them jointly provide a bus or a van to provide transportation. So really and truly, it is wide open. We are wide open to ideas and to what can be done, whether it is getting vehicles that are no longer used by the localities anymore, whether it's procuring those or receiving those as a donation, and how to use those. And again, working with other entities. I know the Chamber of Commerce for the Greater Augusta Regional Chamber, they have a talent coalition and they have been working closely with them, and they've looked at all of these things. So it's really reaching out there and trying to figure out what are some of the ideas and not having any box around what your ideas might be, because you really have to be open-minded and flexible.
That's great. And I'm going to, you all can talk amongst yourselves if you'd like. You don't have to worry about me, but while we're on transportation, Lisa Z, can you talk to us about, you know, is public transportation the answer in an urban area like the one that you served, or where might there be gaps where the public transportation system doesn't really work for a job seeker or a job getter?
Okay, I'm happy to talk about this. So transportation through our HRT Transit Authority, Hampton Roads Transit Authority, is good. The challenge that we have for the Southeast Corridor of Newport News, which we're really trying to revitalize and transform, if you lived in that community and you wanted to go to Thomas Nelson Community College or New Horizons or the Goodwill site, it's, if you were in your car, it's a 10 to 15 minute drive. On the bus, it's 2 hours because of the stops, right? So it's hard to encourage that community to consider it. Luckily, we were one of four in the state that just recently received the Virginia Transit Association grant. So I think Charlottesville was one, Dr. Sharon Johnson might have one, I'm not sure about Richmond, but what that means is it's a pilot for 2 years. It was based on the success we've had with our TANF grant, which is TANF and VUE, basically. It's now, it's branded as Navigating Wealth Building to serve that community. But what we hope to do, we're still in the kind of the launch phase, is to take the traffic's van pools and reroute them to faster drops, faster pickups, faster drops. That funding through that grant came through the General Assembly, so it's a pilot, and it's only for education and training. Somebody can't get on it and go to a doctor appointment, that kind of thing. So we're hoping that that will help and give us some data to show that the traffic's van pools do need to be modified, because they're able to modify those based on supply and demand. In that grant, the TANFU Navigating Wealth Building grant, we also put funding for a 14-person transit van. So our nonprofit partners, the Community Action Program, HRCAP, Hampton Roads Community Action Program, they have that 14-person vehicle van and another one for an instructor should they need to transport to a different site, take them to training, take them to employment. But there's not many Uber drivers. There are taxis, and then there's carpooling, but we do try to add a budget line for transportation. It's a little bit of a challenge, yeah. Well, we're getting there.
So, good, that's great. And Elizabeth, you know, there's a question in the chat that has to do with COVID-19, which is the, you know, the elephant in the room and has completely upended how we've done business. Related to transportation, although tangentially, is how technology might help overcome maybe some short-term transportation challenges. And I wanted to know, what has CCWA done with technology that might help with that single parent who not only maybe not has a transportation option that's working great for her or him, but also is trying to be the schoolhouse in their own, you know, in their own home. What have you all done differently?
I'll be happy to take a stab at that, because I'm very proud of the fact that in our Fast Forward Workforce Credential programs, which are largely populated by job seekers that either have been impacted by COVID, lost jobs, dramatically reduced working hours, or they're low income, sometimes very low income. We have enrolled and are serving 1,950 participants since July. And that's wow. In the flush of the pandemic. Admittedly, we were struggling in April, May, and June while we learned how to deal with that. The new enrollment hub, because we're gonna have enrollment hubs in multiple agencies in Greater Richmond, the Community College and our CCWA, our Community College Workforce Alliance, will be one hub. We'll also have them in the workforce centers and eventually in other public and private places where people go to get job information as well. But in CCWA, our new enrollment hub, headed by a really strong professional named Mary Jo Warsko, they've been very smart about the fact that if you're gonna work with people who need help with their skills, they're largely confined to their neighborhoods, You can't just, it's not enough even to give them a laptop and a hotspot, which we've done. The community colleges have done that, but that's not enough. They've stood up curricula where they have technology tutors to teach them first to live online, to learn online. That's other than for our children, perhaps, that's not a organic skill. And we've had to do a lot of slowing down and teaching how we're going to learn online. But the other thing that CCWA has been successful in, and I'm going to be honest with you, 100% online has not gotten us to the completion and credential rates that we have gotten when we practice very safe, socially distanced, hybrid education. We do what we can online, but we can't train where I can get people to work really quickly in a pandemic environment is in truck driving, it's in healthcare, it's in trades, it's in warehousing and distribution and logistics. Those require hands-on components. And we've done that socially distanced with shields and running weekends, running nights, running days. So it's combining technology, getting laptops into the hands of students who don't have access to technology, getting them access to hotspots, keeping computer labs open on campuses like in downtown Richmond that are easily accessible on public transportation, teaching them how to learn via technology, teaching them the ins and outs of Zoom and learning platforms, and then doing a lot of listening and watching the outcomes of our job seekers to see what's working.
That's great. And just a plug on the transportation piece, TomTom is having a session on April the 7th at 1 o'clock that is going to talk about one of the out of the box ideas to mirror what Dr. Johnson said, out of the box idea that we have here in Charlottesville that is really launched in combination with the local car dealership and the local United Way to address the transportation challenge, especially one that is keen with our shift workers, particularly in healthcare, where no matter how robust your public transit system is in a small city, those buses aren't running in the middle of the night when shifts are starting or ending in the early morning hours. And so I encourage you to tune into that one as well. I'm gonna ask you all, you've talked about the challenges, you've addressed some of them in particular, you've talked about navigation and the need for wraparound supports, that people need the credentials, but they also need the transportation, but they also need the childcare. Can you just elaborate a little bit more on what is it about the Network2Work framework that makes you believe that it could be a tool in overcoming those challenges that you've seen over your years of workforce development? And I'll throw that one to Lisa.
Okay, I really do wanna highlight this, Ridge, and I'm glad you asked. So to me, the app is a way that somebody can privately search their own personal resources, right? Without any of us knowing. If you, mental health, returning citizen, childcare, whatever your housing, you know, we have a housing center. So in addition to that, you have the navigator. So it's self-directed or it's supported. So I think that is just a priceless situation. And it's in one tool. You don't have to search the web. It's right there and it's localized. That's what I like.
That's great. Sharon?
Yes, I think one of the beauties of Network2Work is that it provides a very organized, coordinated pathway for all of us, not only for the job seeker, but for the employer and for all of the entities that work in workforce development and provide supports in the community. So previously, what we have had is we have had job coaches, basically, that have been working with job seekers. And they have, over the years and through their various positions, have developed their own personal network of providers and nonprofits that can support these job seekers. But we haven't really developed in an organized, formal way a network of the entire community that provides these resources. And then therefore it is really asset mapping of what your providers are in the region. And you can see who is providing, where you're heavy in resources, that you have many organizations that provide one particular resource. And then you'll find that you have gaps where there's no one in the community that's providing a resource that's needed. So you need to deal with that. So it is really a formal way of putting this together and coordinating it across the entire region. I know it sounds like that sounds very simple, but it's something that had not organically developed and formed on its own before until being presented with this model and how much sense it makes. And it helps to tell these networks together, working together, supporting job seekers and getting them into the jobs that employers have. That together is something that everybody in the community can get behind and knows that they know that it is needed. And it's an easy way to tell the story and explain what is happening in your communities. And no matter what organization or entity that you're talking with or presenting to, it does provide that.
Elizabeth, you want to hop in?
Well, I really relate to what Sharon is saying. It's Network2Work system and the technology, the promise of both, that's so appealing to me is firstly, I started with my story, job seekers need a goal and does not come automatically either. So the system allows the job seeker to envision a goal, but then there's a plan for getting there. And we're all of us who are trying to assist this job seeker to make the goal, we're all finally, for the first time, on the same page. We know what our assigned responsibilities are. There's a plan for the job seeker, but paradoxically and wonderfully, there's a plan for each of the providers who are assisting that job seeker. So there's a plan, there's accountability, and I think that with that and a clear vision of where we're trying to go, we're going to see significantly improved success. There's also the promise of continued services post-employment. And that post-employment has been a territory that traditionally workforce development providers, no matter public or private, we kind of drop the job seeker off at employment, you know, mark that outcome as having been achieved. And yes, we would follow up for the purposes of data collection and reporting, but with Network2Work, there's really a community that's been established around that now employee and the opportunity to continue that coaching, to continue some level of services until that individual is stabilized and out of the woods, you know, ready to succeed on the job.
You know, that is so important. That question has come up in the chat is that we don't end at the water's edge of employment, that especially as we become more sophisticated and understand that entry-level job that job seeker has gotten is critical. You know, that $30,000 a year job is, that person is earning twice as much as they would have working full-time at minimum wage. But we can't stop there. We can't stop there when it takes $40,000 a year, for example, for a single mom in the Charlottesville region to provide childcare and transportation, as well as food, shelter, clothing, utilities for her family. So, can you talk a little bit more about that post-employment piece? I'm just going to give an example from our own experience here in Charlottesville. We had a mom who had a great job, but she had to move from Charlottesville to the Valley and change jobs. So she was out of work for 3 weeks. She got behind because of that on her rent. And so she had to go to a title loan company to get cash. And she put up her Sienna minivan, her Toyota Sienna minivan as collateral. And over the 12-month repayment period, she paid more in interest than she got in the loan. So she paid $1,200 back in the loan and paid over $2,000 in interest so that she could meet her rent needs. So that's the kind of thing that even when somebody's successfully gotten the job, we need to continue doing. What are your all thoughts about that continued assistance and the career ladder opportunities that people have? I'll just throw it open to any of you all. Thoughts on how that can work?
We just did recently a focus groups with employers, and in there, employers were talking about they have experienced employees who have problems with transportation and getting back and forth to work, and they are late X number of times, and they have met the threshold of they have been late enough times that they now must be let go. And the employer did not understand that transportation was an issue for this employee. And if they would have known that, they would have in some way worked with the community resources or with the employee to try to work out something so that they could have retained their job. So that was a real eye-opening experience in listening to employers that want so desperately to retain good employees, their employees, and have a problem doing that when they don't know the background story. And of course, the employee is trying to keep it a secret because they can deal with it. They can work something out. They can make it happen. And that's where the navigator comes in, and that contact with that now employee is necessary to say, how are things going? What other issues or concerns do you have? And then when there is successful retention, to say, okay, now have you thought about the next step? What is the possibility of movement up that ladder and making additional money, and what training might be needed, and what are the steps to do that? So getting an individual employed, a job seeker employed, and then retention is one that impacts and is of great concern to the employee themselves and also to the employer.
Yeah, Ridge, I think the strategies are just now being worked out because this is new terrain for most of the participants in the coalition. But I think it's important to note our regional coalition has some major anchor industries that are advising us about the needs of manufacturing, about the needs of healthcare, et cetera. One of those is VCU Health. And they brought to us when we were putting together our goals, we want to use Network2Work to increase access to services by job seekers, engagement by business and industry, workforce readiness by those whom we're trying to connect with jobs. They insisted that we look at that issue of retention and success post-employment. And we've learned from our employers that that is a critical issue and one that they see as very relevant to what has become a corporate awareness of the need to drive more equitable programming for new employees to really help. It's not enough to bring in underrepresented populations and give them that first job. They really need to help them succeed. So we've got industries that are very serious about doing just that and expecting us to provide a longer continuum of services than we have in the past.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Well, I see that we're at 11:45. I'm just going to give each of you 30 seconds for any closing remarks about how you see this unfolding in your community or any closing remarks you want to add. So Lisa, we'll start with you.
Okay, great. So thank you again for inviting me. We are very excited about Network2Work on many levels. It is a mobile device and everybody lives with their phone. Like I mentioned, we have a community that is missing broadband, but we're working on that. It supports our Choice Neighborhood Initiative, which is a $30 million HUD program for our Southeast community. It aligns with our city strategic plan, and there's community connectors. So We are totally excited. We have businesses engaged. All the partners are engaged. So we're very excited. Thank you.
Great. Sharon?
Yes, we are thrilled with this Network2Work service delivery model and the app, the technology that goes with it. We here in workforce development have never seen anything like this that is such a coordinated, aligned initiative. It instinctively or from the grassroots up, it addresses the job seeker, it addresses the provider and the community aspect of it, and all of those that want to help to support this effort with job seekers getting to employment. And most of important, it supports the employer, because without the job, we're never going to get anywhere getting people employment. So it brings all of these aspects together, and it brings the community together. And we are, in addition, very excited about the aspect of the community network, the volunteer network, that really reaches into the community and has the connectors that are influential in their community, and then the navigators that are other volunteers that help the job seeker through. And then we've got the other resources that have been there, but that volunteer network has not been coordinated and has not been aligned with the work that we've done. And so bringing all of these entities together and having everybody say, no one entity can do this alone. It is bigger than all of us. We all have to work together to make this happen, has been a tremendous in lowering silos and, you know, anxiety or whatever, however you want to say it. But it's been a tremendous effort and everyone working towards the same goal. And that's betterment economically in every way of the community.
Elizabeth, last word.
You know, I just have never seen, I've never seen a platform or a system that has as effectively in my region united public and private organizations around goals. We have organizations that are standing up personnel on their own dime to support Network2Work. There's just a sense of excitement. There's a sense of genuine collaboration, and we're trusting each other more. And I have sat on many, many, many regional plans to, you know, to develop the new plan for federal workforce funding, et cetera. But this is different. This is intimate work together on a daily basis. And it's bringing us more in touch with each other and each other's capacities, talents, bench strength. And it's bringing us closer to the job seekers. And it's bringing us closer to the community organizations that know those job seekers and can create a bridge, so that finally we're serving individuals that workforce should always be serving. I think we're at the cusp of something very big in Virginia.
Well, thank you all very much for your conversation. Sharon, Elizabeth, Lisa, thank you so much. And thank you, audience, for joining us for this discussion. We look forward to a follow-up with you via email.
Yes, and thank you, Ridge, for this next installment of the conversation around Network2Work. We hope that it continues into the future. And Lisa, Elizabeth, Sharon, it's been such a pleasure to host you on our platform. Audience, thanks for being here. There's more programs throughout the week that'll talk about these issues, so we encourage you to join us there. And I believe a few of the panelists have some follow-up resources to share, so keep an eye on your inbox, and we'll be sure to get those to you.